All right, so now we will see how to study TestNG, that how to work with TestNG. Till now we have studied all the Selenium commands, how to read Excel files, properties files. Okay, I'll make a new project known as TestNG underscore Selenium. Right. Look, the thing is, why do we need TestNG first of all? Where does it fit in? All right, I had explained you with the help of a diagram earlier as well. I'll make that in a more better way, that when you are working with Selenium, it is not just that you have to work with Selenium, you have to build your test cases. All right, and sometimes you have got huge number of test cases as well. So if these are your test cases, just a minute. Yeah, suppose if these are your test cases, so this is my test case one, this is my test case 2, test case 3, test case 4. Okay, so you have to run them one after another. Okay, Selenium will be inside the test cases. Selenium will help us interact with the browsers. Sometimes you don't want to run all of them. You want to run selective test cases. That is, after TC1, I just have to execute TC4. I want to skip TC2 and 3. Sometimes you have to implement grid so that the test cases can be executed parallelly. To save the time, they can be executed parallelly on a same machine or on a different machine. Okay, right. Now, out here, you have to read data from XLS. Okay, right, and just 1 minute, guys. Something is hanging. Yeah. You have to read the data from the Excel file or the properties file into the test cases. Then you have to generate reports. Okay, right. And there are a lot of things. All right. Now, out here, it's not so simple because Selenium doesn't have these features. Okay, Selenium will never have these features to read the data from the Excel file or properties file or generate the reports for you or help you integrate all the test cases with Jenkins. So it becomes a little tough. So what we have is that we have a centralized controller. Okay, this centralized controller can be JUnit or it can be TestNG. Sometimes people use BDD, Cucumber or JBehave. Okay, so we will study TestNG over here. The remaining of them are covered in the videos as well. They more or less, they do the same things with some different commands. That's it. So this centralized controller will help you read the data from the Excel file, generate the reports and all, integrate it with Jenkins. It will call the respective test case, pass over the data to that in that order, serially or parallelly, however you are running. Okay, so this is important. Selenium has got no features to actually read the data or to manage everything. This blue box, this box on the right side, this is Selenium. Alright, so now till now we have just studied Selenium, we have not studied the central part. So I'm going to start off with this now. So the first thing is that installing TestNG. TestNG has to be installed as a plugin inside Eclipse. Okay, for that you just go to Google and type TestNG Eclipse. Alright, you will get the first link. And you go to install the plugin and hold on, you get this link. I'll give you the link on the WebEx chat as well. Okay, You install TestNG from here, go help, install new software and paste the URL, hit the enter button, install TestNG as a plugin. Instead of pending, you will see TestNG coming up over here. Alright, fine. So you can install TestNG. You just have to click on next button at the bottom. Okay, and TestNG will be installed. Your Eclipse might also restart in the end. Okay, rather it will restart. Alright, after restarting, you can go to Window, Show View, under Other. Inside Java, you will see TestNG. If you see this, then that means TestNG has been installed successfully as a plugin. Now, in TestNG, there is no main function. For example, under the source folder, I will make a new package known as test cases. Package is basically a folder under the folder. Okay, if I go to this project, alright, if I go to this project and if I go to the project path on the hard drive, hold on. And under the source folder, I will be able to see the test cases folder. This is a package. Alright. And under this test cases package, let me make a simple class known as, say, send mail test. Okay. TestNG has got no main function. In TestNG, there are predefined annotations. What do you mean by that? For example, if I write @test public void login. So this @test is your annotation. This means that this login is a test case. Alright, you move the mouse over it and you will get the option to add the TestNG library in the project. You can add the TestNG library and then you can move the mouse again and you can have this import test option. You import it and you will get the import over here. So you have to first add the TestNG library. The TestNG library will have nothing but the TestNG jar file. That's it. Okay. And inside it you can write like starting login test. And then you can have some Selenium code over here if you want. And then you can print ending login test. Okay. You can run this file. You can right click on it. Alright, you can right click. And you can run it as a TestNG test. You'll get this option. You run it and in the console, you will get an output like this. Total test runs are 1, failures are 0, and skips are 0. You will get everything printed over here, that starting login test, ending login test. But we are basically building test cases now. Alright, TestNG is not just meant for Selenium. It can be used with anything. Okay, in the results of running the class, you will see that in graphical format, it will tell you that login test is passing. Alright, if you right click on the project, you will get the option to refresh the project. Okay, you will have the test output folder. In this, if you expand it, you will have the default HTML reports. If you open index.html, this will automatically be generated. Guys, please. Yeah, please. It comes up automatically. Yes, when you run the project, it is created. When you run the project. Okay. So now, if I open this index.html, I'm sorry. If you open this index.html, it will have the login test over here. This is a default HTML report. This is not a very good report. We don't rely on these reports. We will see how to generate way good reports than this report. Okay, I'm going to tell you about something known as extent reports. We will see that. Okay, these are extent reports. This is extent report. Let me show you. This is extent report. We will be building these kind of reports. Okay. These reports are way better than the normal reports. They have got description for every test case, that what's happening when it was running and what is the graphical pie chart representation of the execution as well. Okay. Right. Now, similarly, you can have multiple tests. You can write @test public void, say send mail, and you can print over here sending mail, and then @test public void logout. I have performed three test cases. So these three will be different test cases. Alright. Right. You can also run it from the run button on the top. There is no main function in TestNG. Okay. Right. If I run this, it will present over here total test runs are 3 and failures are 0. So it will run all the three tests. If you look at the read output, you see that? Don't you think there is something wrong over here in the output? Do you think that something is wrong? Yes, the order. We expected that the order should be first this test should run, then this test, and then this test. But this is not happening. Logging out is printed before sending email. So don't expect that the order would be the order from top to bottom. No. You have to prioritize your test cases in TestNG. You have to write in the bracket over here that priority equals to 1 for this test case. For the second test case, priority is 2. For the third test case, priority is 3. Okay. Right. Now when you run this code, you see that out here you will see starting login test, ending login test, sending mail and logout. It will be printed in this order. I hope you are getting my point. Now what if you have to do the validations or pass or fail the test case or something? I'll make a new class known as validations.java. I'll explain you in this. I'll make a function known as @test public void say test app. Alright, import the test annotation. Now suppose in testing what we have? We have an expected value. And we have an actual value. You have to basically compare an expected value with an actual value. Expected value can be kept in the Excel file or a properties file. Actual value will be coming up from the application. I'm sorry. Okay. You have to compare them. So in TestNG, we have the assert class to do this. Assert class in TestNG does this. Write assert, move the mouse, and make sure you import assert from org.testng. Sometimes people import this assert class from JUnit. Don't do that. Please import it from org.testng.assert. Okay, you write assert dot, you'll get a lot of functions. If you write assert.assert equals, you can compare the actual value with the expected. If both of them, they don't match, the assertion will fail. If I run this code, you will see that total test runs are 1 and failures are 1. In the console, you'll see that. And you will have this small TestNG tab over here. Click on this. In the results of running the test also, it will show you fail. Expected A but found B. So with assertions, you can pass or fail the test case. Well, there is one more type of assertion function. You can write assert dot assert true. Okay. What do you mean by assert dot assert true? All right. You give a condition over here in this. For example, 4 greater than 3. And you give a message. This message is basically error message. If I run this code, this assertion will pass. That means the test will pass. It will be green. Basically, it means that whatever condition you are writing over here, that condition should evaluate to true. If that condition is evaluating to true, then assertion will fail if I pass. If I write 4 greater than 13, this is false. If I run this code, this will actually print. This will actually fail the test case. You see that? It is actually failing the test. Right? Now, what you want, how will you use this assertion? Remember I had actually told you about a function, is element present. You can call that function over here. You can give the XPath of that element. So if that function returns you true, that means that element is present on the web page. Assertion will pass. Otherwise, it will throw the error message. Okay. So this assertion is used in some condition. If that condition evaluates to true, pass the test. Otherwise, you fail it. Similarly, you have got assert dot assert fail, which is false, which is opposite of assert true. If the condition evaluates to true, it will fail the test. But generally, we use the first one only. Okay, assert true. All right. Now, sometimes you are in a situation where you are sure 100% that the test has failed. For example, you are on a page, you click on the link, and you get a 404 error. Or you are on a page, you click on the link, and the next page which opens up shouldn't be the page which should actually open up. You are 100% sure that this link is taking you to a wrong web page. So you can fail the test case like this, assert dot fail. And you can give the error message, whatever message you have to write. This message over here is the error message. If the test case is failing, somebody asked a question, what is this error message? It does come up. Hold on. I'll just write over here error message A, and if I write over here assert.assert true, 4 greater than 13. Okay. If I run this, right, this will, you see that? says over here error message. Okay, right. Hope you got my point. Okay, right. Now, sometimes you are very sure that the test has failed, so you can directly use assert.assert fail. So you can use it anywhere. For example, I can fail my login test. I can write over here assert.fail and you can put the error message. And when you run this code, you see that the login test will fail. But again, do you see anything weird happening out here? What do you see? Yes. These two tests have passed. Why? They should not be passed. So you can introduce dependency between test cases. You can write over here that this test case is dependent on the methods. You can give the method name as login. Okay. Right. So if you run this, yes. So you see out here, this will fail it and this send mail is skipping. Okay, you can make it dependent on multiple tests like this. You can do it. Login, comma. You can write send mail. Okay, so you can make logout dependent on both of them. So when you run this, the other two tests will skip and this will be failing. You can deliberately fail the test as well. Sorry, skip the test as well. If you are on a test case and if you don't want to run it, you want to skip it, you can write over here, throw new, skip exception. You can throw a skip exception, skipping the test because of some reason. So when you have got 1000 test cases and you want to run say 500 out of them, in the 500 test cases you can skip the test by writing this command. So generally we keep, you see that it skips the test case. Generally, we keep the information in the Excel file that which test case to execute and which test case should not be executed. Okay, in a list, and based on that Excel file, we'll do it in the frameworks. I don't want to go into elaboration. You can keep the information that if there are 10 test cases, you can keep the information in the Excel file that which test case has to be executed. And correspondingly in the code, you can throw the skip exception for the test cases which have to be skipped. We will do that. I'm just giving you the commands now. Yeah, tell me. As I told you, for example, you click on a link and you get a 404 error. Okay. Or you click on a link and you reach a web page where you are very sure that this web page should not be had been there. It's a wrong page. Okay. Or you enter a user ID and a password on a website, which is a wrong user ID and a password, and you actually land up on a web page, which is the inbox. So you are very sure that you the test has failed. Okay. Yeah, you reach a scenario where you should not be reaching. Okay. Right. That's how you fail the test.
I'll tell you in the frameworks. Okay, we keep a list of test cases in the Excel file and we skip the test cases which we want to skip. Okay, right. Now, in TestNG, you can also do parameterization. Okay, I'll tell you. For example, I'll make a simple class known as LoginTest. Look, everything will fall into the places. I've taught you Selenium separately, TestNG separately, reading files separately. Everything will be clubbed together in the frameworks. Okay. If I write @test and public void to login. All right. Now suppose I have to execute this test multiple times with different sets of data. This will only be executing once. If I run this code, it will just execute once. What if I want to execute it multiple times? Well, for that, it's very simple. There are steps involved over here. Okay. Right, I'll tell you. The logic first. Basically, we keep the data in a two-dimensional object array. I hope you know what a two-dimensional array is. It's got multiple rows and multiple columns. Okay. Right. The number of times you want to run the test case is equal to number of rows in the test case. And the number of columns in the test case are equal to number of parameters in the test case. So for example, in this case, I want to run the test 3 times. The first row will hold the data for first execution. Second row will hold data for second execution. And third row will hold the data for third execution. All right. So you have the annotation @dataProvider for this. So there are steps involved in this. Okay. First you have to make data provider and link with test. I'll make my data provider annotation public object get. This function getData will return you a two-dimensional object array. We make a two-dimensional object array which will keep the data. Say the number of rows are 3 and number of columns are 2. Okay. It's like first you specify number of rows and then columns. That means I want to run the test case 3 times and every time there will be 2 sets of data. I can fill the values. I can write data 0, 0 equals to username 1. Data 0, 1 equals to password 1. So this will be my first row. Then second row of data. We can write data 1, 0 equals to username 2. And data 1, 1 is password 2. So you can put up 3 rows of data in this file. So this will be 2, 2. I hope you know 2-dimensional arrays. All right. This will be the 3rd row. And you return the data. So you build a data provider first and mention the data in it. Make sure you fill in all the rows and columns. And you link the data with the test case. You have to mention in the test case that the data provider of this test is getData. This function getData is providing the data inside the test case. The second step is number of input parameters in the test. The number of input parameters in the login test should be equal to number of columns, because number of columns specify the parameters in the test case. Over here we have got two parameters, username and password. I'll print over here executing login test, I will print the username and then I will print the password. That's it. You have to do these two steps, nothing else. When I run the test case, TestNG will execute the test. It will read that the data provider is coming from the getData function. So it will go inside the getData function, gather the data, and then it will automatically call the test case three times. First, it will call the data with first set, second set, and then third set. Okay, if I run this code, see, it will run the test three times. U1, P1, U2, P2, and U3, P2. Alright. So it will execute the test case three different times. Okay. If I put a breakpoint inside the test case and a breakpoint on line number 17 inside the data provider, run it in the debug mode, you will see that first, click on yes, first the control will stop inside the data provider. The test is not executed first. First the data provider is executed, data is collected. If I hit F8, then the control will stop inside the test. I'll hit F8, 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 and all the three tests will run. Now the mistakes which people do in this. The primary mistake which people do is that the number of input parameters should be equal to number of columns. Sometimes they give three columns and two parameters, and if you run the test case, you'll get an exception. Okay, that test data provider is trying to pass three parameters, but the method is accepting only one. If you read this carefully, or only two. So you have to be careful with this. Alright. Everything is inbuilt, you just need to configure it properly. So you can run single tests with multiple sets of data with the help of data provider. Okay, now you can also batch run your test cases. I have made these three single Java files. I can execute them individually. But if I want to batch run them, I can also do that with TestNG. Okay, there's a question being asked. So if I have to pass over five parameters, what will I do? If you have to pass over five parameters, you will have to give number five over here first of all. And in the first row, instead of like, you will have to write five data sets, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 3, like that, till 0, 4. You got my point? Okay, you'll have to write five parameters here, give the number five here, and put the values in all the five cells. You got it? Right. Now, as I was telling you, you can batch run the tests as well. You can run the tests together, okay, in a certain order. And that can be done with the help of a file known as, hold on. testng.xml. I'll take this file, you can also take this file from the project, I'll upload it in the code. Okay, so you can give the name of your suite and then the test cases.
The first test case is login test is inside the package test cases dot login test. Second test is send mail test. It is inside the package test cases dot send mail. And third test case is say validations test, and it is inside the package test cases dot mention the name correctly. This name has to be correctly mentioned. If you mention it wrongly, it will give you an error. This name can be any name. It is up to you. But this name has to be the fully qualified package name with the name of the class in the end. And the test cases will be executed from top to bottom in a serial order. When you run this, you will see that all the tests will be executed. First, the login test executes, send mail, validations in a serial order. So test engine, you can take my file, okay? Otherwise, don't take the headache of creating it. Everybody copies it from the TestNG website only. If you want to create it yourself, you can go to new file, name the file testng.xml and write all the code inside it. Generally, we don't do it because if there's a proper structure, you copy it and you alter the structure the way you want. Okay. Right. Simply copy it, and in the project you can right click and paste it like I did. I copied it from the hard drive and I simply clicked on my project and control V. I pasted it. Okay. Yes. Everything. Look, I am giving you all the projects. They are uploaded on the drive. You can download the project and you can import the project directly in your workspace. Instead of copy pasting individual files, you can go to file import, and under general you can go to existing projects into workspace, and in your outer you can browse the project and go to the project root directory and you can import it in Eclipse. Only the thing is, the project will have errors. You will have to go to the properties and remove the jar files and put your jar files. Okay. While removing jar files, again, people do a mistake. Don't do the mistake. They remove the JRE system library as well. Don't remove this. Only remove the jar files. Okay. Right. So I'll stop here. Okay. It's been quite a lot. All right. We'll meet next weekend and we'll continue. Yeah. For POI API, you need to add 5 jar files. I gave the link. Yeah, for POI API. So I'll upload the code and the video. Okay. I'll share it next week, Payal. I'll share everything. Yeah, tell me. Yeah. I'll tell you the solution. I have a video on this. It's on my website. Hold on. If you want to find the Facebook friends exercise, if you want to do it, hold on. Hold on. If you have to build the script for that, you can refer this module, this video. No, I am not sharing my screen. Take this URL. Next week I am going to discuss topics and frameworks. The exercises and the frameworks.
make my trip exercise, Facebook, and few exercises and the phone. Look, the thing is, you must be using some element pre-extracted in the next page. Stale element only comes up in that case. Please mute your microphones. Just a minute, I'm muting. I'll mute. Yeah, I've muted it. Yeah. Yeah, tell me. Okay, just post it in the forum once. Post it in the forum once. Post your code in the forum once. Okay. Yeah, I did not get a chance to check the forum. I was not well. Today or tomorrow morning, I'll check the forum. Okay. I don't want to do that right now. Okay. I'll give you next week everything. Have you logged in? You have a different username and password for the forum, you know that, right? No, then you should be able to post. You should be able to post then. Let me check it out. I will drop you an email. Let me check it out. Okay. Yeah, so you need to set the notification off in the profile. Let me check it out. Yeah, because for me it does. I'll check it out. Okay. You can mail me the code as well. That's okay. The latest version of Firefox is now supported by Selenium. Maybe you have not given the profile correctly, because it does actually work. It doesn't work like that. It does work. Just check it out once very carefully. No, implicit wait is for driver.findElement commands only. Implicit wait is only for driver.findElement commands. No. Okay. So fine then, I'll end up the training. Yeah. Thank you.